Okay, so in the beginning, I made some brief remarks about the so-called Vedic mathematics, which is about some computations, which is making big rounds. So and the main thing I would like to emphasize is that it has nothing to do with the Vedas. That is that's the main message. Now about its utility, etc. I will, as a scientist, I will not try exceed my brief about what can be said about it. As far as I am concerned, it's not very useful. But this is something we should, you can make your own assessment. Now, but the main thing to emphasize is that it is not from the Vedas, and the idea that it is brought, developed, derived from Vedas, etc., is being used as a marketing device. Even now, I find that many of the websites, when they talk about this, they are not only saying that these are efficient methods which can be is a testable thing, but also claiming that it is the mysterious wisdom from the ancient times, etc., and it's nothing of the sort. And it's really we really need to be clear about this part. So let us look at what does Vedic mean. Now, Veda of course comes from the certain compositions, documents, which were important at a certain time in the Indian civilization. The Vedic period is, of course, people have made debate about this. This can be put plus minus. I mean, sometimes people might want to take it way back, etc. But the point is that there is a certain limited period which might have extended to our side up to 500 BCE, which can be called the Vedic period. Now, if someone says we are in the Vedic period today, is totally in a different page, on a different page, then so it doesn't make sense. Vedic period has to be understood within these parameters. Now, Vedic texts are a repository of knowledge of those times, which is it's about those times. you might limit it to precisely what is codified in the Vedas, or something that is related to it, that something you can derive from that something you can understand from that, etc. But it has to be in a certain cognitively related, very very specific way. It should be related to this period. It's a repository of knowledge of those times. Characteristic features of the cultural, about that period, the few things to good to keep in mind. There were pastoral people in the form of village communities, and performance of yajnas in pursuit of material and spiritual goals was one of the characteristic features of those. And one should maybe emphasize for those of you, the younger generation who may not know, that these yajnas were actually in a way a substitute for these temples and pujas, etc. Temples and pujas, etc., did not exist in the Vedic period. So it is the yajnas were the essentially only interaction with the divine, if you believe in such a interaction at all. So and that was the context for the yajnas. So it had an all important role to play in the society. So from the mathematical point of view, what was the mathematics that was involved in that time? I mean, you need to look at history in its context, in the context of the period. So some of the mathematical highlights are decimal representations of numbers, the use of zero, geometry involved in the construction of Vedas and Vedis and Agnis. Vedi is the platform and Agni is the fireplace. Mathematical texts from the Vedic times are the following: the Shurva Sutra. There are Shurva Sutras. Actually, there are many more Shurva Sutras. These are some of the important Shurva Sutras that have been studied: Baudhayana, Apasamba, Manava, Katyayana. And among the highlights, I have mentioned Pythagoras theorem. I also mentioned some other things in the earlier part. So that's roughly the mathematics. There is also the Vedanga Jyotish, which are not mentioned here. But that's the general. So now let's come back to the so-called Vedic mathematics. Do the sutras convey any mathematical ideas? So So what is the significance of the eight tricks? So these are various questions I have put down, and maybe we'll go over the discussion. We will have the discussion over that. So here, so in the context of these, there are the following questions one should ask. So do these sutras convey mathematical ideas? Is the significance of the, what is the significance? Are these tricks ancient? Actually going the right way. What is the role of VM vis-a-vis mathematics, and how worthwhile is it to pursue Vedic mathematics? This is something I already went over. It should some way be something that can be inferred in a logically satisfying manner to be from the Vedic civilization. That is what should be called, can be called Vedic. Even though Veda means knowledge, not everything that we get to know over the course of history, say inventions of our times, can be called Vedic. And this seems tautological and almost unnecessary to say, but this is the sort of logic that is actually applied by people, including in the book on Vedic mathematics, where he says Vedas include everything, and hence therefore it includes this, etc. But then by extension it could also include many more things that we are talking about now. And then if it does, then why do we claim it to be ancient? Then so you cannot have it both ways. There is a certain absurd self-serving argument involved in what they are saying. So here I have quoted some usual propaganda about that. So amazingly compact, powerful system of calculation. Once you have learned the 16 sutras by heart, you can solve any long problem. The actual quotations that I have got here from the propaganda sources. So incredible hyperbole indeed. The system made its first appearance in print in the book Vedic Mathematics. This was first published in 1965. It was authored by Sri Bharati Krishna Tirtha, Shankaracharya of Puri Math, from 1925 until his passing away in 1960. The book was published later on, posthumously. The book presents some sutras claimed to be from ancient Vedic lore. It describes some procedures supposedly coming from the sutras to deal with specific arithmetic algebraic operations. These are very limited operations. This is something to keep in mind. So the sutras, are they from the Vedas? In fact, they have nothing to do with the Vedas, nothing to do with the ancient Vedic texts at all. Not only the Vedas, even the later ancient texts don't have anything to do with that. So the Vedas have been well documented and thoroughly studied by various scholars, and there's nothing akin to these sutras of VM to genuine Vedic literature. Yeah, there isn't any other text either. So these sutras, actually they add up to barely 50 words in Sanskrit, made their first appearance in Tirthaji's book in 1965 in print. Of course, they may have been there, he may have used them earlier, but not much earlier. The style and language of presentation is alien to Vedic texts. These are one should remember that the language, Sanskrit language itself, evolved over years. The language of the Vedas is quite different from the later Sanskrit, especially the one that was common post Bhaskara and in the recent centuries. I mean, Sanskrit was used as a scientific language in India until 16th, 17th century or even later, in parallel with English to some extent. For instance, some of these scholarly works on music, for instance, are in Sanskrit. But the language is considerably different from the earlier language, and one can make out the age from the usage. So in case, so these have nothing to do with foreword. So, and curiously, the general editor, V.S. Agrawala, he is actually an Indologist himself, and he mentions in the foreword to that book that it points to their discovery by Sri Swamiji himself. So the language itself, he was an Indologist, and he was keenly aware of this thing. And nevertheless, I don't know, because of the weight that the Shankaracharya carried as a holy man and so on, many people seem to have ignored all these contradictions and fallacies and followed that. is also another thing I want to mention. There's a well-known historian of Indian mathematics called Krupa Shankar Shukla, K.S. Shukla. He has done a lot of research in the actual ancient Indian mathematics, and when confronted by Professor Shukla, a scholar from ancient Indian mathematics, the Shankaracharya replied that the sutras were only his own parishishta of Atharva Veda. So it's actually an admission that the real Vedas, the real Vedic texts do not contain the sutras, and the admission is by the person himself.
What is Parishishta?
Pardon?
What is
Parishishta? Parishishta is the word for appendix. Appendix.
Appendix.
So now James Glover is one of the people from the UK who was instrumental in promoting this. He himself also, in a letter to me, says that considering the style of Sanskrit used in the sutras, together with the report that they were found only in his Parishishta, it seems more likely that he discovered the sutras himself. Now, do the sutras convey mathematical ideas? This is a naive belief fostered by the author and later by others that they do. It is patently absurd. Now, here is an illustration. Now, for instance, Ekadhikena Purvena, this is the first sutra in the of the 16. Ekadhikena Purvena just means by one more than the previous one. Okay. So it's not even a full sentence, it just says one more than the previous one. Such a string of words which is open to different meanings in different contexts does not convey any particular meaning. So something that you can use, say in a variety of different contexts, it means that it really doesn't have its own intrinsic meaning. Specific meaning can come from it only from a context which is not available in the present instance. So what do the sutras of VM correspond to? They are nothing but tabs stuck to certain procedures in short phrases or titles. So they can at best help to recall the procedure or the trick. So Ekadhikena Purvena, which is by one more than the previous one, there is a certain process, there is a certain trick which involves using something that comes previously and more adding one to that, etc. And if you want to remember that process as a like a mnemonic, you can remember this string of words, and this is sometimes called sutra in another context, but it is not Vedic sutra. It is so sutra can also mean something that you use as a mnemonic or some cue for doing to remind you of a certain operation. So in that sense, it is what is involved here. So tabs stuck to certain procedures in as short phrases or titles, they can at best help recall the procedure or trick. The trick itself had to be known separately. The tabs might just as well have been in any other language, so they didn't have needed to be in Sanskrit, but their being in Sanskrit would and was perhaps designed to impress people, but has no contextual significance. Though if you in fact are familiar, more comfortable with English, you could pick similar strings in English and use those strings rather than the sutras, and it will not change anything at all. Okay, so these Sanskrit sutras should not really impress anybody, which unfortunately it does. can a handful of sutras be key to everything? It is absurd to imagine that the 16 sutras hold the key for everything. Now each one stands for specific things with a bit of variation here and there. The sutras do not even cover things that are contained in the book itself. Now the author keeps adding and what he calls sub sutras. It's not it's not enough for him. So wherever he has something new different to say, he adds a sub what he calls sub sutra. And even with that, many things are actually left out. So some of the sub sutras, Veshtanam, Vilokanam, are too general even as a tab for or procedure. Now Vilokanam could as well be an instruction to watch out at a traffic lights. I mean, it's just a joke I have made on that. So something like Vilokanam, Chintanam means think. So observe. Yeah, so now how ancient are these tricks? The tricks by and large could not be very old. In the first place, for a trick to be relevant, trick to be known, the relevant concept needs to exist, right? So the decimal point presentation involved in the first trick, the Ekadikena Purvena, is everything in fractions. Yeah. So decimals did not exist, and one illustration of this point is that in the Bakshali manuscript, they're writing huge digits with fractions, in the vulgar fractions, as we call them.
But so, when you first slide on reading this thing, you saw decimal representation and zero.
I mean, no, that is integers. Integers, that's for integers.
In general, it is not very good. It not really
yeah. So here, these are decimal fractions. So this decimal point representation refers to fractions. It is by 1 upon 19, 1 upon 29, and there is a way described to how to write 1 upon 19, 1 upon 29, numbers like that. And in decimals, there is a certain recurrence that occurs, and that is to be used. But there are no decimal fractions in the works of Bhaskaracharya from the 12th century either. Not only Bhakshali, but even Bhaskara. So the many other operations involved also have no relation with ancient Indian mathematics. All the way from the Shulva Sutras to the Vedic, of the Vedic times to Kerala mathematics, which is the golden period, the peak of Indian mathematics. The book shows also acute lack of awareness of the genuine ancient mathematics, given especially the context that the author is trying to be superlative about Indian achievements. The kind of calculations dealt with could not have been frequent occurrence until the 20th century, because these arithmetic computations have a certain context. You don't keep once they are in practice, there can be academies or schools to train you for that, but for the use to arise in society, there has to be a certain context, and that context really arose only in the 1920s, mostly in the 20th century. One should also remember that much of the earlier transactions in the old world were by barter, and the money itself was not the mode of exchange. So money had to be there these kind of computations to be relevant. Tirthaji's exposition of tricks, perhaps only some to begin with, came in the first half of 20th century. They may in fact have come into general use just around then, and Tirthaji may have been the first expositor. What is the role of VM in mathematics? Mathematics in all majesty consists of, this perhaps doesn't bear repetition, but anyway, let me do that. Deep ideas concerning numbers, computations, shapes, Yeah, so we were at during the break we were talking about what is mathematics. So I feel that one shouldn't try to define what is mathematics. It's like saying what is food. So food is whatever you begin to discover is edible and does good to you and so on. So in the same way, mathematics is something you begin to use in this or that context. So this, like you began to use numbers, shapes, then you found interrelations, then you found interrelations between their interrelations and so on. So in a way a certain theory develops organically. Now tomorrow there may be an entirely new way of doing something that is relevant and can be used in our context where we use mathematics, and that will be mathematics also. So like food, mathematics is something that grows with your experience, with your understanding. So here are some ways things I have put together just to give an idea. So concerning numbers, computation, shapes, symmetry, movement, so like acceleration, the idea of measuring acceleration did not exist until a few hundred years back, and then now it is an integral part of mathematics. What is the speed at which the car is moving, or were you accelerating or not accelerating? So interrelation between various structures, etc. Several branches such as group theory, topology, algebraic geometry, harmonic analysis, combinatorial mathematics, to name just a few. So now Vedic mathematics, this VM, on the other hand, is a handful of tricks involving elementary arithmetic and algebra. Moreover, these lack generality of in applicability and theoretical coherence. So even within them, it's not a coherent, even for arithmetic, it's not a coherent theory. It's just a bunch of tricks applicable only in certain special instances. It's like knowing shortcuts in a big town. You might that you are so familiar with. Maybe you know a few shortcuts for going from one to point to another point. Of course, the such information knowledge can be useful, but how much time you want to invest in learning about these shortcuts when you can actually go to Google and find your way is something that needs to be taken into account. Now, in fact, it's important to focus on concepts and their, yeah. In mathematics, it is important to focus on concepts and their interrelations. This is you need to understand at the basic level. You need to understand how to write a number in units, tens, hundreds, etc. You need to understand what their products will be. So these are some of the things that have been understood and expressed and codified all the way from Brahmagupta. I mentioned Bhaskara and Bhaskara's Leelavati. So there are methods of computation. These are not only for a certain special situations, as is the case with Vedic mathematics. Vedic mathematics of Shankaracharya. So that coherence which you find even in ancient works like Brahmagupta or Bhaskara is totally lacking in VM. VM simply tends to spoon feed a few concoctions which are far from being needful to the mathematical diet of the student. How worthwhile is it to pursue VM? The only use of tricks of VM is to help speed calculations in certain situations. In particular, the main aspects of clarification of concepts, logical thinking, etc. are not served by VM. So it's very important that, see, for a child, it is important to know what is behind, what is the basis of what the operations he does, what is the base, what the get a view, I mean the fundamental understanding of what is involved in terms of concepts, rather than being able to perform a certain sequence of operations and get to the answer. That is what would happen in case of practice of VM. Excessive focus on VM can therefore be positively harmful to the overall growth of a child's mathematical talent. Being able to calculate fast has lost its importance it once had with the advent of calculators. It is like the ability to run fast while it could be useful on occasion, hardly anybody would consider it worth investing effort and money on such endeavor when you can use a vehicle to go much faster. Both of these are worthwhile if you have a flair for it, or your particular context demands it in a certain way. But you have to consider how much effort and money are worth spending over it, and not be carried away by the propaganda around. It's often claimed that Vedic mathematics is well appreciated in other countries and even taught in some schools in UK, etc. This is of course a very standard ploy in any propaganda. That is, even if you don't see many customers here, we have a store elsewhere. St. James, this school. This is one of the earlier schools which in London, which is known to have introduced, which is often quoted in this context. It's a school. Now, this is a school. I know more about this school. Actually, we had a friend in London who introduced me to some of these people, and so I got to find out and even correspond with the people. So this is a school. It's called the School of Economic Science, which according to a letter I got from James Grover, engaged in practical study of Advaita philosophy. So it's being in London, in England, is needs to be seen in context. I mean, it's an extension of some of the Advaita philosophy, etc. So the claims of appreciation abroad can thus be very misleading. You need to see them in context. So here is a remark. If attaining skill in speed arithmetic is the aim, VM is really but one stream. There are also other systems, going back to the Trachtenberg speed arithmetic from the 1950s and its later day variants. There are also many other more subsequent variations of that. One ought to take comprehensive and objective view and not be carried away by the load of ancient wisdom stuff which is not even true. So while the utility of VM cannot be totally refuted, which is usually the case with many things, there are many stories about something you would argue to be useless, and then it turns out that there's a long story which at the end of which this is what is it is important. So there's a Panchatantra story where there's a sage who wants to wed his daughter to the son. So he asks the son, and then the daughter says, no, maybe I don't quite like the idea. Maybe he asks the son, is there a better groom? Then son says, the clouds overshadow me. So maybe you can consider cloud. Cloud is stronger than me. He goes to the cloud. Then the cloud says, the wind is stronger than me. I get flown with the wind. I cannot control. So then he goes to the wind. And then the wind says, mountains are stronger than me, so they stop me. So he goes to the mountain. The mountain says, you know, I stand still, but these mice, they really bother me. I don't know what to do when they make my goal. So finally, he decides that the mouse is going to be is the right bridegroom.